Good day. Today is February 28th, 2015. We're here with Lieutenant Colonel Richard Cole. I'm very pleased and honored to have Mr. Cole here for many reasons. One, he's an American veteran and he served our country. Another reason is that Mr. Cole himself is the oldest living veteran that I've ever interviewed. He's 99 and a half years old. Mr. Cole, thank you for being here with us today. And we're very pleased to have you and to have you answer some of our questions. What year were you born in?
I was born in September 1915.
September 1915. And where were you born?
In the upstairs bedroom of my parents' home on 747 Faulkner Avenue, Dayton, Ohio.
Is that house still there today?
Yes.
Do you live in that house today?
Yes. Maybe 4 years ago, I stopped and talked to the people that are living in it.
The house is there, and you had opportunity to go back there and visit that house.
Yeah.
And tell me something, did a lot change in that house since you were there? Did a lot of things change in the home that you lived in?
It hasn't changed a whole lot. It was a pretty livable house, and apparently the people that have lived in it since, I'm not sure it's the same family. But they didn't have to spend a lot of money on remodeling.
You lived in Dayton, Ohio, and when you went in, when you were in school as a student, where did you go to high school?
I went to high school, Steele High School.
How do you spell that?
S-T-E-E-L-E.
Okay. And where was Steele High School located?
It was at Main and Monument intersection downtown Dayton.
Is that high school today still active?
No, sadly no. It was demolished, and I don't know what's there now.
When you were in high school, did you play any sports?
No. When I was in high school, I didn't quite weigh 150 pounds, and Not exactly sports material.
I want to ask you, 1941, December 7th, Pearl Harbor is bombed in the Pacific. Many people didn't even know where Pearl Harbor was. Do you remember that day?
Very vividly. By that time, I was in the military in the 17th Bomb Group, the 34th Squadron, and we had been on maneuvers in Southeast Asia with a mock army war. And we were on our way back to Pendleton, Oregon, which was our home station, and we landed in Marchfield, California, Friday afternoon, on would be the 5th. Colonel Doolittle gave us permission to, that was on Friday, and we were given permission to what they used to call the open post. So we all went to Hollywood, and we were down on Hollywood.
And this was now December 5th, from your recollection? That was December 5th? When you went down to downtown Hollywood?
Yeah, yeah.
That was December 5th.
Yeah.
So 2 days later, on a Sunday,
yeah.
You're
Sunday
back on base, I guess.
Sunday at 8 o'clock in the morning, we got the word that Honolulu had been bombed, and that we were to report back to Marchfield immediately. It happened that my father was the contractor, and he had hooked up with a gentleman by the name of Mr. Foster, who, after they hooked up, moved to Hollywood. We had no way of getting back to Marchfield, so I called Mr. Foster, and Mr. Foster took us back to Marchfield.
Marchfield was located outside of Los Angeles?
It's about 60 miles east of Los Angeles.
So here it is, you're reporting back to base.
Yeah.
Now, you were, at that time, I guess it was called the Army Air Corps?
Yes.
Okay, it hadn't officially received the name of the Air Force, the US Air Force at that time.
The US Army Air Force.
Okay,
but Air Corps.
Air Corps. And then the name changed to the US Air Force.
Yeah.
So here it is, you're in Los Angeles. Pearl Harbor's attacked. Did you hear President Roosevelt's speech that day?
I think so. We were in pretty much hyperactivity because as soon as we got back to Marchfield, we were, had to round up everything and take off immediately and go back to Pendleton, Oregon.
Now, once you got to Pendleton, Oregon, your orders must have come through. Is that where you were stationed, and how long were you in Pendleton, Oregon?
How long I was in where?
In Oregon. How long were you in Oregon?
After we got back to Pendleton, our mission was changed, and we had to do some changing about the bomb rack. Instead of bombs, we put in depth bombs, and were sent to Portland, Oregon, Everett, Washington, and there's one other place, Seattle, on submarine patrol.
And how long did you continue the submarine patrol? Till when?
About maybe a month. I remember that we got orders to go to Columbia, South Carolina, under the street word, I guess you call it, that we were going to go over to Africa. I remember that we left Pendleton on Valentine's Day in 1942 and flew to Columbia.
In 1942, were you married? Were you married at the time when you were
no.
in the service?
Mm-hmm.
I want to take you back a little bit.
All right.
When did you enter the service? What year did you join the military?
1940 in November. November the 22nd.
November the 22nd, 1940. But prior to 1940, were you also in the service? Were you flying planes before 1940?
No.
Okay. Were you drafted or did you enlist?
I enlisted.
What made you enlist in 1940, before the war even began?
Well, I did a dumb thing. Early on, I had decided that I wanted to be first an Army Air Corps pilot. And if that didn't work out, I wanted to be a forest ranger. And I went to work on a farm, my aunt's farm, for $75 a month in room and board. And I made enough money to start the school at Ohio University. Okay, and I had tried to get into the Army Air Corps twice. I went to Wright Field and took the tests and so forth, but At that time, the Army Air Corps was a stepchild of the Signal Corps. And consequently, when budget time came around, the budget for the Army Air Corps was a lot smaller than the Signal Corps, for political reasons, I guess. Anyway, I figured that my chances of getting into the Army Corps, Air Corps were not too good, so I better direct my energy toward the forest ranger. Between my sophomore and junior year in school, I heard about the civilian pilot training program. So I applied for that and was accepted and passed the thing and got a license. And had to sign a paper because Uncle Sam was paying the bill. You'd make yourself available if there was any kind of a fiasco. I waited after I got my license and had made a committed myself with a signature. I got kind of anxious, so I went to Fort Thomas, Kentucky, and enlisted. And which was dumb. My orders to go to flying school may have gotten lost, and I would have ended up in marching. But as luck would have it, I was there at Fort Thomas, and my job was running a centrifugal tub for potato peelings. It had a tub that had a lot of spikes inside of it, and they peeled them.
It's like an old dryer in the old days that would just spin around. This one took the peel off the potatoes.
Yeah. But fortunately, I only did that for maybe a month or so, and I got urged to go to Parks Air College at St. Louis.
And taking you back now, 1942, you were transferred to the East Coast at one point. It's 1942, the war is on. And what type of plane were you piloting?
In 42, we had B-25.
And those were double-engine planes? Those were two-engine planes?
Yeah.
Now, what were you doing on the East Coast?
We had involved in a mock war with the Army. We dropped these blue, what they call blue bombs that had no sand or nothing else in them. But they, when they
hit,
they let out blue smoke.
And how long did that go on?
We got there about 'On the way there, we stopped for a few weeks at, now this is from September on, in Jackson, Mississippi. And then we moved over to Augusta, Georgia. Being in the Columbia and flying out of Columbia, went up into North Carolina. But we were temporarily at TDY there at Columbia.
Was there any theater other than the Pacific that you were engaged with? Theater of war. Were you ever in Africa? Were you ever in Europe during the war?
No, not till afterwards.
So when did you first fly out to Hawaii?
We didn't go to Hawaii. We left Pendleton. And we were headed for Africa. We got to Columbia, South Carolina, and they put out the word about the mission. And we got the word about the mission. We got a the ones that they picked to go got transferred to Eglin, Florida. And we did all our training for the Tokyo Road out of Eglin Field, Florida.
And you were with Doolittle that entire time?
No. I was crewed up with a National Guard pilot. And we trained, started training. Well, partway through the training, he became ill with appendicitis or something, and he was disqualified. So that left the four of us. Yeah. We talked it over, and I went to the operations officer and told him we wanted to still go, but we needed a pilot. And in between time, I had been upgraded to first pilot, but I didn't feel confident enough to do whatever they had in mind because I didn't know what they were going to do. The ops officer said, well, the old man is coming in this afternoon. I'll crew you up with him, and if he would do okay, you got yourself a pilot. Doolittle came in and took that gentleman's, the one that was sick, took his seat, and that's how we got crewed up.
And that was the first time you met Doolittle?
Yes, but I knew who he was. I had a scrapbook all about him.
Did you? Were you kind of excited that you were put with Doolittle?
Oh, yeah. First class gentleman.
So why did they pick you? How did you end up? Was that just luck?
It was just luck.
It was just luck. So how long was it before Doolittle looked at you and said, hey, you know what you're doing. I feel comfortable with you being my co-pilot. Did he ever tell you that?
No, but he didn't fire us. So to me, that's good enough.
So when did you and the crew head out overseas?
Doolittle came in at 11 o'clock. At 1:30, we left Columbia and flew to southern Florida, where he had some business. The next day, after he did his, we were at Wright Field, and then the next day we were back to Eglin Field.
And then when how many missions did you have before the raid on Tokyo? Did you have any missions prior to the raid on Tokyo under your belt?
Only training.
Only training. So that theoretically was your first real bombing mission then, wasn't it?
Yeah, but we weren't. We didn't do much bombing. Right. We had practiced that before.
Right. So when you took off for Japan, where were you exactly? What island were you on when you took off for Japan?
When we took off for Japan, we were from Alameda, California.
Okay, and from Alameda, California.
After they loaded us on the carrier.
And then they put you guys on the carrier. So the planes actually did take off from the carriers when they did the raid.
We were supposedly about 750 or 800 miles east of Japan.
When did you find out that that was going to be a mission, that you were going to be on the first bombing raid on Japan? When did they let you know? Did they keep it top secret while you were aboard ship? Or did you know once you were on ship, that was your mission, you're going to be going to Japan?
I think it was about the fifth day out of San Francisco that the PA system came on and said, this force is bound for Tokyo.
Your commentator is Basil Rysdale. Now it can be told. History in the making. That the mysterious Shangri-La, actually the United States Navy aircraft carrier Hornet, steams westward across the Pacific. a protecting force of cruisers and destroyers, with the hard-hitting Admiral Halsey in command, slams into a gale, determined to reach a position 400 miles from Tokyo, unless intercepted by the enemy. Packed on the after deck of the Hornet are 16 B-25 Mitchell bombers. Never before have these huge planes been launched from a carrier. High explosive and demolition bombs are made ready for the destruction of military objectives in Japan. Colonel, now Major General Doolittle, with Captain Mark Mitcher, commander of the aircraft carrier Hornet, who was once decorated by Japan, now gives his medal to be returned to the Japs on the tail of a bomb. Not until they are miles at sea do these men know definitely the mission for which they have volunteered. Now their thoughts go back to their months of careful preparation, clothed in the greatest secrecy. Only Colonel Doolittle knew that Japan was to be their target. Now they realize that the miniature cities laid out for practice bombing near an American airfield duplicated military objectives in Tokyo, Yokohama, Nagoya, Kobe, and Osaka. Even the strategy of flying in low over targets is an important part of the training for the greatest surprise raid in the history of aerial warfare. Not even certain they can take off successfully from a carrier that was never designed for launching army bombing planes. Closer and closer they approach enemy-controlled waters and the danger of discovery. Jimmy Doolittle and Captain Mitcher discuss every detail of the carrier takeoff. Suddenly, a strange vessel is sighted. It's a Jap patrol boat, and the task force intends to destroy it before a warning can be radioed to Japan. Lifeboat goes to pick up Jap survivors. It is feared they have flashed the news to heavy Jap naval forces in the vicinity. Survivors are picked up and brought aboard. Jimmy Doolittle asks Admiral Halsey to go in closer for another hour and a half. And now the signal is flashed for the takeoff, 10 hours ahead of schedule. The added distance to be flown increases the hazards. There is no hesitation. They man their planes. Doolittle pilots the lead plane. There's a breathless moment as the big bomber gathers speed. It's airborne. The first Army bomber ever to be launched from a carrier is safely in the air. Now they know it can be done, and they time their takeoff with the upsurge of the bow of the carrier in the heavy seas. Next to go, nose wheel lifted and wing flaps down for maximum lift and the quickest possible takeoff. Another B-25 to join the formation circling over the task force until all the 16 planes can get into the air. Tokyo ahead. Here is America's answer to treachery. Secret Norden bomb sites have been removed from these planes and replaced by a makeshift device costing about 20 cents. These historic pictures round out the electrifying news of Tokyo's first taste of American vengeance in April 1942. Loaded with eggs of destruction, they wing through a fog-ridden dawn. One of the last planes to go almost meets disaster on the takeoff from the rolling and pitching deck of the carrier. It drops dangerously, but good piloting saves it. The planes sweep in without being discovered. They separate into groups to attack the several objectives carefully selected by means of accurate intelligence to ensure that only targets of military value will be hit. Colonel Doolittle himself has told of flying over the Emperor's palace and refraining from bombing it, though he could have left it in ruins. Here are the last pictures to come out of Tokyo before Pearl Harbor. They show the Japs rehearsing with all the realism possible for air raids, which they assured the Emperor and people of Japan would never be experienced. The defense system, as they practice it here, proved disorganized and panic-stricken when Doolittle and his men catch them flat-footed. Not a single shell fragment hit a plane. The loss of face by Tokyo may well have driven the Japs into the disastrous Midway expedition and its staggering losses of ships and men. This Jap-made scene of Tokyo swept by fire following an earthquake shows clearly what must have happened in the many areas hit by the hundreds of incendiary bombs.
Now some of the people knew of Eddie, but most of the second lieutenants, which I was one of, didn't know anything.
What kind of practice did you have prior to being out there by taking off an aircraft carrier? Did you have any experience for taking off and landing on aircraft carriers? Did you practice that?
Yes. The Navy, when we were at Columbia or Eglin Field, the Navy sent a young lieutenant by the name of Henry Miller, who had never seen a B-25. And they sent us to learn how to make a carrier takeoff. And he did a very nice job.
So you had the training there.
Yeah.
And in 1942, let me see the date I have here, April 19th was the day.
18th.
April 18th, excuse me.
Yeah.
Let me just take that off.
It was interesting to know we were turning toward China. But we did it anyway.
You had no resistance from any fighter planes?
No.
They never sent up any planes? And what do you think the reason was that no planes came up to shoot you down, no fighter planes? They didn't have any at that time?
First off, we were surprised but happy. We were flying low altitude and about 4 hours into the flight, Hank Potter passed a note up to us that we were going to end up 180 miles short of the Chinese coast.
What type of landing did you have? What type of landing when you had to force land the plane?
We didn't force land. We got to a point where Hank thought we would run out of fuel. Yeah, and we still had fuel and everything. We realized that we had a tailwind. And Mother Nature had given us a pretty good shot that we had enough gas to keep on flying until we got to China.
And when you got to China, did you land a plane or was it Doolittle who landed the plane?
Neither one of us. We climbed to 9,000 feet and bailed out.
And everyone bailed out?
Well, we were in a weather situation. We couldn't see the ground. There was a big active warm front with all kinds of lightning and rain.
Was there a chance that you might not have been over land?
No. When we arrived in that area, we could vaguely see in the rain deal, the coast. So we knew we were over land.
And then he gave the order to bail out.
Yeah.
Now, how many crew members bailed out? How many men bailed out altogether?
The whole crew bailed out.
And how many were in the crew?
Five.
Five.
Yeah.
And were all of you, did you end up in a close proximity to one another when you hit the ground?
You mean with other crew members or other crew?
With your crew.
No, we're in no contact.
Were you separated from everyone else?
Yeah.
So when you landed, did you land in a jungle? What did you land in? Did you land in a town when your chute came down?
When we bailed out, we were over a mountain range, very steep. There was no forward visibility. Mm-hmm. There wasn't any visibility at night because of the fog and rain. So we didn't know where we were or how close we were to each other.
You bailed out of the belly of the plane?
Yeah.
And when you got there, it was nighttime. It was nighttime, correct? Did you move around at all at night, or you just basically took precautions not to be spotted, or to make sure that there was no one there that wasn't friendly?
We had no idea what the terrain was, and when we bailed out, we were very apprehensive about what we were going to hit, because you couldn't see anything. And it turned out that we bailed over on the west side of a mountain range.
And did you have a good landing?
A very good landing, because my chute drifted over a small pine tree, and I ended up about that far from the length of that wall, from the ground. I had a flashlight. You couldn't see because of the fog. And
so right. Forth.
But at any rate, I decided to stay in the tree, so I stayed in the tree.
Until when, the morning?
Until morning.
When was the first time you saw another member of your crew? Did you see anyone the next day?
The next morning, the storm had passed and we started walking. And
did you have a compass?
Yes.
What kind of compass was it? One of the little ones?
The little tiny one.
Which was the size of a quarter or less than a quarter?
It was about the size of a quarter.
Okay.
But it was served a purpose.
Yeah.
Started walking west, because if you went east, you'd walk right into the Japanese hand. At that time, China was cut off.
Right.
All the complete border, clear around the Rangoon and Burma.
So here you are, you're walking. How many hours, how many days did you walk before you saw some friendly faces?
That night, just before dark, I was walking and I came out on a cliff. Down below was a little paramilitary group, a couple of buildings and so forth. And
these were Chinese soldiers?
Yeah, it had a Chinese nationalist flag line. So I walked down there and I was accosted by a young soldier, and I got him to take me to where
his commanding office?
He took me to a building. That inside the building was a table like this, and on the table was a piece of paper with a two-tailed airplane and five parachutes coming out of it. And I finally got him to take me where he took the guy that did the drawing. We went to walk for about 5 minutes. And came this other building, and it was pretty dark. Mm-hmm. And I walked into it, and They were having candles that put out a lot of smoke, and you had an overcast in the building. And I could see the shadow out of my eye that there was another individual, and it wasn't until I got up close, about like this, that I noticed it was Doolittle. He's the one that drew the drawing. So we greeted each other, and he commented that he was happy that I wasn't injured. And about maybe an hour later, a friendly group of Chinese brought in the rest of the crew. So we were all together that night.
That's amazing. How long was it before you got back to the Americans?
I didn't get back until 14 months later.
Later in China, the flyers who bailed out safely are decorated by Madame Chiang Kai-shek. The smiling Jimmy Doolittle does not yet know the fate of some of his comrades. All survivors, except the crew of one plane which landed safely in Russia and were interned, reach America and are decorated by General Arnold, head of the American Army Air Forces. Doolittle wins the Congressional Medal of Honor. Mark these men well, General Tojo and his barbarous war bandits, who boasted they had executed some of the flyers captured. General Arnold replies to this brutal news with fighting words.
Those men died as heroes. We must not rest. We must redouble our efforts until the inhuman warlords who committed this crime have been utterly destroyed.
Tokyo Raiders, Captain Watson right and Lawson left, tell of targets bombed and vengeance to come.
Our takeoff from the Hornet was made successfully. It wasn't as much the length of takeoff that bothered us, it was the width. It was about a 4-foot clearance between the right wingtip and the island, the left wingtip hanging over the deck on the left-hand side. Trip in was uneventful. My first target was a tank factory in the south of Tokyo. My alternative targets being an oil storage tank and a railroad yard. We were fortunate in getting through the anti-aircraft and reaching our number one target. It dropped the entire load on this tank factory and had the satisfaction of seeing two of the bombs score direct hits.
Captain Lawson speaks for his comrades.
We all feel pretty strongly about these boys that we were with. We had all been pretty close, large family, almost like brothers. We'd known each other from a year to a year and a half before this raid ever came off. We knew their families, their children, and if there's any way to get even, we'll certainly try.
What happened during those 14 months?
Well, one of the carrots that they dangled in front of you for volunteering was that if you made the trip and successfully, that you'd get to come home. Well, they did the right thing. When they got them all together, they selected the ones that had sprained ankles and everything, and they sent them home first, which is fine. But with the promise that the orders would come to the remaining group, that they would get to come home. Something happened to the orders. They were in file 13. There were 26 of us that didn't get to come home.
And you were one of the lucky 26.
Yeah, well, it didn't make a lot of difference. We had to fight the war somewhere, so.
Right, right. So, for 14 months, where were you in China?
I was stationed in a place called Chaoba. It was an air base.
And it was a Chinese air base?
Yeah.
Did you see any American planes there?
Well, what happened? While we were there, they decided to establish the air link between India and China, which was known as the hump.
Yeah.
So there were six of us that volunteered to get retrained and go on the transport route. And
so you were flying the hump?
Yeah. 14 months later, I got to come home.
And you got to go home. Now, when you got home, was the press waiting for you? Did they greet you? Did they know you were part of the Doolittle Raiders? Was there anything?
They weren't even around.
There was no fanfare when you got home?
No. Never talked to them.
Did anybody know about the Doolittle Raiders? Did your family or your parents hear about it? And did they know that's where you were? Because nobody heard from you for 14 months.
I know.
They didn't know you were missing in action for 14 months?
We also had been cautioned not to broadcast it. The fact that there were still people in the theater, and the Chinese had put a $5,000 bounty on Brick Holstrom's head. So it was better not to say anything.
Now, tell me about Rick Holston. Tell me about Rick Holston, who he was.
Okay, Brick Holstrom was commander, a major, of the 11th Bomb Squadron in China. It had B-25.
And why did they want a price on his head?
Well, because he was a Tokyo Raider.
Now, he was on one of those planes?
Yeah.
Okay. And what was his rank?
I think he was a first lieutenant. Pilot of, I don't remember.
How did he get along with Doolittle? Did they get along?
Oh, yeah.
Now, what plane was he on?
I don't know. I have to look it up. But
now, your plane, did it have any nose art on it?
No.
Nothing? No nicknames, nobody's girlfriend or anything like that?
Doolittle didn't believe in that.
After the war, did you keep in touch with Doolittle?
Every time, or 18th of April came around, he was a commander. You got a letter about the reunion would be somewhere.
And you got to see. After the war, you came home. Did you have any other brothers or sisters who served in the military? Any brothers or sisters that served in the military?
Yeah, I had two brothers that were in the military.
Were they in a Pacific or European theater?
One was in North Africa and one was in the Pacific.
Did they know about the Doolittle Raid and that their brother was on that plane?
I don't know.
Do you still have news articles from those days?
No, I'm the last of my... I had... three sisters and two brothers, six altogether, and I'm the last of the one.
Do you have any pictures of you with Doolittle?
I may have.
Did you take a lot of pictures when you were overseas?
I didn't have a camera.
So every picture you got is something somebody may have given you a copy of. I want to ask you, if you had some advice today, the 28th of February, 2015, you're 99 and a half years old, you've seen a lot in your lifetime. If you were to give advice to today's young men and women about how to go through life and how to make America a better country, because you are the greatest generation, how can these young people today can follow in your footsteps and the footsteps of those that you grew up with to also become a great generation? What would you say, what would you recommend talking to an audience of young people who are junior high school, college age, what would you say to them if you could give us some advice?
Well, if you're talking about somebody that it was out of college, okay, and the aviators, if I had all the training that they get and so forth, I would say that keep on course and remember that you have one commitment, that if your country is involved in a fatal war, that they had better enlist and do their part. If it's the young people, I would say remember that you're living in one of the best countries. You enjoy all your privileges. You better study hard and be ready to fight if necessary.
Do you think today's young men and women, compared to the years back in the 1930s and 40s when you were just coming out of high school, do you think they have the same values that you had?
No.
70 years earlier?
No, unfortunately, I think we have lost our nationalism vigor. But I also feel that we would be surprised that there would be enough people step forward that knew what the hell was going on and get things organized.
I'm going to ask you a very controversial question that you may have been asked before. Knowing what you know, living through the war years, do you think that President Harry Truman did the right thing by ordering the bombing of Hiroshima and Nagasaki, by dropping the atomic bomb on those nations? Do you agree with that, and do you think it was the right thing to do?
I think he made the right decision. He was the one, Japanese would have really stonewalled with everything they had, and we would have lost many, many thousands of people. That Harry Truman did the right thing.
And do you believe today that Harry Truman's act finally brought the Japanese down to their knees to bring a hasty end to the war?
Yeah. But another thing I believe about Henry Truman, not many people know that before he was president and you were in the military, you could not vote. Harry Truman took care of that. He signed it off, and that's why I voted for him.
I want to thank you very, very much, Lieutenant Colonel Cole, for giving us this opportunity and giving me the honor and Patrick the honor of being here as you recorded your life during that very, very difficult time.
You're quite welcome.
Well, thank you. Thank you very much. And I look forward to seeing you again and again. And hopefully I can say the next time I see you, well, we're up to our 100th birthday, and it's an honor to be here today with you and to have interviewed my oldest veteran to date. You have the record, sir.
The
record.
And I hope you can sit next to me, too.
Exactly. Thank you so much.